I'm going to ask those of you who are standing or who are still outside there, if you'll just come in and take your seats. We want to allow plenty of time to have conversation with those of us who have been gone a long time. We want to allow enough time for them to dialogue with us as long as they can. The president of this very fine institution, Dr. Hogan, is away on campus business and unfortunately is unable to be with us this evening. She's saddened by the fact that she can't be here today. But when you're president of an institution, particularly small private one like ours, you just can't always be at home. In fact, most of the time, you're not at home. She said this morning how she is looking forward to coming back here and getting in her own bed. She's been gone for a while. But she sends her regards and all of her hugs and kisses to everybody here, particularly those who have now come home. So, to Dr. Leslie McLemore, who is the director of the Fannie Lou Hamer Institute at Jackson State University, and who has put so much time and energy and love into making all this possible. And Dr. McLemore, on behalf of Dillard, which is our sister institution, and to everybody at Tougaloo, you know it happens sometimes. We'd like to thank you for your hard work in making this possible, and I'd like to give him a round of applause for the work. Thank you, Mr. And to our special guest, Dr. John Dittmer, thank you for all you have done all these years and for the wonderful book, Local People. Thank you for being here this evening and serving as moderator. And to everybody out here, all our family, our friends, our students, allow me to greet you this evening by reminding some of you and introducing to others of you that when you entered through the gate onto this campus tonight, your movement thereafter has been on sacred ground. Behind where you're sitting and across our yard is a building that is surrounded by protected wire and is offline to us here, waiting to be finished with reconstruction. It is called the Mansion and was the first building on our 500 acreage. It was originally known as the Big House on what was a slave plantation. Out back of this building is where our campus library now stands. And to the left, and slightly to the back of it, were the slave pens. They were all located back there. We believe that these grounds are fertilized by the blood of our ancestors. And it is these grounds that have kept us safe. all these years. So our stories are far-reaching and often filled with some of the best folklore. For example, through the years, our students have told us that they have heard the organ playing in this chapel when in fact there was no one in here. I know for a fact that there have been entrances and exits late at night in the mansion when I was the only one there. All of these notwithstanding, whether we were initially supposed to be here or not, off these grounds and through these gates, Tougaloo College has contributed heavily to this country's pool of humanists, scientists, educators, and social scientists. Through the hands, for example, of Dr. Ernst Berensky, emerged Dr. Joyce Ladner and Casey Morrison. Out of science is Dr. Robert Smith. Out of humanities is Dr. Townsend's Jerry Ward. And out of the early 1960s is a group of whom we are so proud, and when we look at them, still brings tears to our eyes. They are called the Tougaloo Nine. Young men and women who placed their lives and their baccalaureate degree at stake and did what they believed and what they knew to be right. Operating out of what is Tougaloo College's mantra of activism, they took a step off these grounds straight into the Jackson Public Library, picked up books, and began to read. This was March 27, 1961. For picking up books and reading, they were arrested for what was called disturbing the peace and placed in a Mississippi jail. They are here tonight, and we welcome them home. Even though they're going to be dialoguing with us, I just have to have them stand. Meredith and Junior, please stand. James Bradford, we know him as Sam. Alfred Cook, Geraldine Edwards Hollis, Janice Jackson Vales, Albert Lassiter, Ethel Sawyer Adolphe, and I would like to have the family of Amina Evelyn Pierce Omar, the only one who is not with us physically, but I can promise you she's in here today. Would you please also stand? So these are they, the wonderful ones. The individuals who, whether they understood it or knew it or not, you changed this Mississippi, and you changed this country, and we are so proud of you. Welcome home.
Thank you, Provost Betty Parker-Smith. On behalf of the AIM Institute at Jackson State University, we are just excited to be associated with this event. We are most appreciative that Tougaloo let us participate with them this evening. This is an evening that I have been long awaiting. I was in Memphis at the National Civil Rights Museum a month or so ago with John Dittmer. John knew then that he was going to be the moderator. And every other word John talked to me about, he said, man, I'm looking forward to having this conversation with the Tougaloo now, you know? So John, brother, this is your evening. You will have a conversation with the Tougaloo Nine, and we can all listen in on this conversation, which is absolutely great. But let me just say that I think this has really been an awesome day at Jackson State with the number of outstanding presentations we had on the campus. But it started really last evening. Dr. Latner really set the tone for today and for this evening. Dr. Latner did an outstanding job. And I don't know whether she's here or not, but she did a phenomenal job. So tell her, if you see her, that Joyce, you did well. And in her absence, let's give her a rousing round of applause. And let me do something quite unconventional, but this is a shameless plug, quite frankly, for Keith MacMillan, Dr. Daphne Chamberlain, who is Tougaloo 2001, who has sent out more emails than any human being in 1 week, in 1 month on the face of the earth. And I'm sure the brothers and the sisters and the nine have been overwhelmed. But this young lady is not only brilliant and bright, obviously she's attractive, but she absolutely loves Tougaloo College. So let's give her a round of applause. So for a 40-year member, Jackson State faculty member, and a graduate of Rush College, to be in the midst of all these Tougaloans, it's like, man, you've died and gone to heaven. This is all right. So thank y'all very much. And I'm just so pleased that we could be a part of this.
Joyce just walked in,
and I talked about it before she got here, you know. So, all right, Joyce, I said good things about you. Michael, our graduate assistant, and Jaleesa, our graduate assistant, they have been with us throughout. So this is really an evening for the Tougaloo Nine. The courageous, bright, energetic young people that helped, as the provost pointed out, to not only change the face of Mississippi, but to help change the face of America. And I'm delighted. And in this audience, we have some of the veterans of the Mississippi Civil Rights Movement. And I would be remiss if I didn't ask the veterans to please stand and take a bow. Let's give them a rousing round of applause, too. And I just learned and just read recently that the former chaplain at Tougaloo College, one of the outstanding, Tougaloo had a lot of outstanding chaplains, but Ed King was one of the best. And I just read recently that the National Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee is going to award Ed King one of its Freedom Awards on November the 12th in Memphis. So Ed, are you still here, brother? All right. Now, you know Ed is a Millsaps graduate, but wherever he goes, he takes a bit of Tougaloo with him. So, I don't know. I'm not the mayor and I'm not the governor, but since I'm not the mayor, I'm not the governor, let's declare, all of us, the people, that this is Tougaloo night, Tougaloo day, Tougaloo week, Tougaloo month, Tougaloo year.
Our moderator for the evening. And just to kind of give you my background with this person, because he has been very significant to my own professional growth and development over the years. But in the spring of 2001, I had the opportunity of being chosen as a senior to present my senior paper at the Aaron Henry History Conference. And little did I know, the one person whose book changed my life so much, I would be able to meet him. And when he approached me, the first thing I asked, can I get your autograph? But what I remember most is what he wrote in that autograph. And that was, he saw in me something that I didn't even see in myself. And that was a promising young historian. And all these years later, 10 years later, I have had the opportunity to be in his presence ever since then. Dr. Dittmer, John Dittmer, is Professor Emeritus of History at DePaul University. From 1967 until 1979, he taught at Tougaloo College in Jackson. Among his books, Local People, The Struggle for Civil Rights in Mississippi, won the Bancroft Prize in American History from the Organization of American Historians, the Lillian Smith Book Award from the Southern Regional Council, the Macklemore Prize from the Mississippi Historical Society, and also the outstanding book on the subject of human rights given by the Gustavus Myers Center. In 2010, Dr. Dittmer published The Good Doctors, The Medical Committee for Human Rights and the Struggle for Social Justice in Healthcare. And this was, of course, an organization that provided medical assistance for civil rights workers in Mississippi during the 1960s. I present to some of you and introduce to the rest of you my dear friend and inspiration to my own personal research, Dr. John Dittmer.
You promised you wouldn't make me cry. Good evening. I'm always delighted to come back home, but tonight I am particularly honored to be in the company of this group of women and men who made history a half century ago. Both Provost Betty Parker Smith and the eminent man from Russ College, Leslie Macklemore, have taken my introduction, so I'll cut to the chase. We are all eager to get at the main events. I will say, however, that if you look in your program, you will see a picture of a group of people at a lunch counter being doused by mustard and ketchup, later of being hit. That is the iconic photograph of the sit-ins. It's a group of Tougaloo students and faculty who sat in at Woolworth's lunch counter in 1963. Now, the reason I mention this is two reasons. And one, it was very dangerous to participate in a sit-in in what many people call the worst state in terms of race relations. And the second thing is to point out that these students here, 2 years earlier, staged a sit-in at the Jackson Public Library. Now, we as historians are taught to always be aware that the people whose history we are writing about did not know how their stories were going to end. We can sit back years later and say this happened and they should have done this and they should have done that. But if you will, put yourself in that position for a moment of these people. Young people, college students, who were doing this not knowing what in the world was going to happen to them. They were breaking new ground. Burley Evers, who should know, wrote that the change of tide in Mississippi began with the Jackson Library sit-in. Here, for the first time, young people on their own initiative confronted the forces of white supremacy publicly and dramatically, creating a dynamic that would recur during the 1960s in black communities across the state. It is difficult to single out any one factor that launched the movement in Mississippi, but for me, the library sit-in sits at the top of the list. Tonight we are going to hear from seven members of the Tougaloo Nine. Joe Jackson was unable to attend, and if you heard the sad passing of Evelyn Pierce, Evelyn's brother William will be on the panel representing her tonight. You have heard the names of all of the other people, and we're going to try to keep this informal tonight. We thought we'd have more microphones. It's going to be really informal because we're going to be passing one around. But I want to begin not by doing more introductions, but asking each of them to take a minute to introduce themselves and to tell where they're from and how they got to Tougaloo. And then we'll start with a discussion involving everyone, and at the end, taking time for each person here to talk briefly about what they've been up to for the last 50 years. So with that in mind, I will turn it over to Al, who will begin with first, and we'll pass the mic down the line.
Evening. First, I'd like to say, my, it's great to be back home. As previously introduced, I'm Alfred Cook. I came here from Campbell College in 1961, got involved, was asked to leave the city for protection purposes. I left the city after the sit-in, went to Flint, Michigan, where I worked for the summer, decided to get married, and I did not return to Tougaloo. I regret that because I loved my family here. Having a new family, I stayed in Michigan, waited till she completed her degree. Some of you may know her, Barbara Gill, a junior student here at the time. We had three lovely children, and she has promoted herself tremendously and done well. My career, after getting my degree at the University of Michigan and subsequently a master's at Wayne State University in biochemistry, I embarked upon the clinical sciences. I opened a private testing lab in Flint, Michigan. It grew from 1 to 21 locations around the Midwest. I had several hundred employees, and I did quite well. I did this for 28 years, selling my business and retiring, and I retired well, I'm happy to say. After retiring, I got bored. I was so bored, I was losing my mind. And I ended up coaching high school golf. After that, I ended up teaching science in a local high school, and I was only going to do it a couple of years. 13 years I taught science at a high school. I loved it because I love young people. I've always loved working with young people. And after 13 years, I retired last September, but now I'm getting bored again.
Thanks, Al. You've used up your 2 minutes. The rest of you will have your choice of either telling about how you got to Tougaloo now and telling what happened to the rest of your careers later. We are doing this off the wall. You can either feel free to come up here or we'll pass the mic around. From one Al to another. Oh, first, Gerald.
1 minute.
Good evening. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
My name is Geraldine Edwards Hollis, and I came here in 1959 from Natchez, Mississippi. It's great to know that we have some Natchezians in here. I'm not going to go much further because I have a lot to say. And I'm going to pass the mic. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Albert Lassiter, a native of Vicksburg, Mississippi. It's interesting. Our teachers have obviously a great influence on where we go to college, and our science teacher, my biology teacher, is Mrs. Mary Howard, too. Right? And she insisted that I go to Tougaloo. Thank you, just a little closer. And that was a marvelous experience, and I think it was the best thing that happened.
Good evening. My name is Janice Jackson Bales. I am from Clarksdale, Mississippi. I was 10 when I came to Tougaloo. I came to Tougaloo because I had two homegirls who had come to Tougaloo and encouraged me to also attend when I graduated from high school. So I came eagerly to Tougaloo anticipating wonderful things and was the first in my family to go to college. So I got a lot of support and there were a lot of people who were pulling for me and my family. So I came here and helped this young lady here. Get herself together.
Good evening. I'm losing my voice, so hopefully you can understand. I'm Meredith Anningham from Jackson, Mississippi. I have to recognize my lovely wife and my sister, Dolores, in the audience. Next to the others, our son and our grandson, Chancellor. Any other relatives? I also want to recognize Dr. Robert Smith, who is taking care of a lot of my family members, and I want him to know publicly that I appreciate it, and I'm so thankful. I grew up in a family of 11 children. I'm the oldest of 11. Both my parents had something to do with my getting involved in the West Jackson Youth Council, where I served as secretary and vice president under my cousin, who was serving as president, Willie Slogan. I guess the fact that we didn't have much, you would expect to hear that, okay, I've made it over, but we're still struggling. But at any rate, I ended up at Tougaloo. I went to Jackson State my first year. My first year, transferred over to Tougaloo. And, well, I ended there.
I think if you take a survey of us, you'll find that our parents had lots of cheerings. I was born in Malvina, Mississippi, the fifth of 13 children. My early years were spent growing up in Memphis, Tennessee. I returned to Memphis, to Mississippi in 1958 to attend Tougaloo at the urging of my high school counselor, as I had been considering joining the Army or some other branch of the service because I knew my parents could not afford to send me to college. Anyway, following Tougaloo, I attended graduate school in sociology at Washington University in St. Louis. My working career has included research for Washington University and Tufts University, and teaching at Haverford College and Temple University. I retired from St. Louis Community College First Park campus as Humanities and Social Sciences Dean. I'm the mother of one son.
Hello. My name is James C. Bradford, but I'm also known as Sammy Bradford, Sam Bradford as well. Let's see, how did I get to Tougaloo College? Well, my home is Memphis, Tennessee. No applause, there are no Memphians in here. Well, there's one. About 10 of us came in here in 1960 from Memphis. Some came on athletic scholarships. Young guys, that was the last year for the football team here at Tougaloo College. So I had at least two homeboys to come down on scholarship, athletic scholarship. We had some very fine young ladies to come down on academic scholarships. And I said, young ladies, I was not involved with that. But I did come down on a choir scholarship. Several of us did. And we thought that we were pretty hot. So we had a good time, fell in love with Tougaloo College. And we'll get into the other specifics as time goes on. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is William Pierce, Commander U.S. Navy retired. And I'm number 7 in the family of 11. And of course, Evelyn was number 6. And I always heard, you know, throughout my growing up, what number 6 was up to. But mostly it was said that number 6 is getting into trouble. Back in those days, though, to do something like challenge the system was getting into trouble. So number 4, who is Dr. Amendia Pierce right here, was at Jackson State as number 6 was entering college. We're from Laurel, by the way, and there are 11 of us. After hearing about 13, I don't say 11 too loudly. But anyway, how did she get here? Well, she was a member of the Students' Council there in Laurel, working very hard. And number 4 was up here at Jackson State. And of course, number 6 decided to get into some more trouble, and she applied for admittance in the University of Southern Mississippi there in Hattiesburg, which is 30 miles from Laurel. Well, we knew that she was going to get into some real serious trouble if she got on that campus in 1961. So what happened was, apparently somebody thought it would be too much for Jackson State if number 4 and number 6 were on there at the same time. And there was a consensus of somebody that number 6 should come to Tougaloo on a scholarship instead of getting in trouble at the University of Southern Mississippi. So anyway, that's the short story of number six, and I'm sure you'll hear more about her later. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Now we're going to go into more of the free-for-all. We're not going to ask everybody to respond to every question. If we will have this microphone, we'll pass it around. If the spirit moves you, you can come up here and talk. I thought we would begin by with a very simple, straightforward question, and that is, how did all this get started? What led you all to form the Tougaloo Nine? I thought we would go very quickly from that question into something broader. What we found out at dinner is they don't agree on how they got started. So who wants to start it off?
It's not that we don't agree, we just have different routes. I attended Jim Hill High School, and I became a member of the West Jackson NAACP youth chapter there. We met every week in the office of Medgar Evers. And it was under Medgar that I became associated with the Tougaloo chapter. I only attended about one meeting, and we had gone to the Livingston Park Zoo, Willis and my sister and Amos Brown and a couple other people, and we got thrown out of the park, but they didn't really arrest us. Does anybody happen to know what the problem was at that time at the Livingston Park Zoo? We could go in, but you couldn't sit on the bench. So we went in and we sat on the benches. And for that, we were pulled out of the park, and we failed to do a couple of things. So he thought it would be good if I would participate with the Tougaloo students. And I was in a science class in Kitchell Hall, and Joe Jackson came by and told me they were getting ready to go to the library, and that Mecca had told him that I would be agreeable to participating, and so the rest is history. And that's my account.
I'll be brief. excuse me. Again, I'm from Memphis, Tennessee, and even though we are a different state, we certainly share one commonality, and that was segregation, Jim Crow, black people being downtrodden. We were called colored, by the way, at that time. I don't think we were even called Negroes. We were referred to as colored. And the separate water fountains and restrooms to match. Well, having grown up in that environment, and I'll just make one observation here, my mother started to expect me to assume a responsible role early on in my life. For example, she would send me downtown on the bus to pay bills. And I guess I must have been every bit of 13 at the time. I distinctly remember going downtown, paying the bill, and headed back home. Well, I got on the bus, and it must have been somewhat the rush hour, I suppose. And the bus was crowded. I sat down once I got on the bus, but without thinking, I just sat down. And it occurred to me that I had sat down in front of a white man. And unlike Rosa Parks, I popped up like something had stuck me. I got up and went to the back of the bus, which was my place. But I didn't like it. I hated it. Couldn't explain why I had to do that. So, of course, I discussed it once I got home. And, you know, I was always told by my mother, just don't say anything. That was her favorite phrase, because she knew that I was subject to say something that would get me in trouble. So, fast forward, then I got the opportunity to come to Tougaloo College. And when I got here, and I don't want to go over my time. Are we supposed to be talking about the, how I got started. How the group got started. Well, you know, we're under these strict rules, so we got to kind of try to stay on track here. Because Ethel jumped on me, and I'm going to tell it on. She jumped on me because I told everybody that I was the youngest of the group at 18. And she has been wearing me out ever since. But when I came to Tougaloo College, I found that there was a youth chapter of the NAACP, and they were about to do things. So it was not hard at all for me to identify with that group and to become involved with that group. And that's how I became involved. And we ultimately sat in, of course, at the library, and that's how I became one of the Tougaloo Nine.
Because we have been discussing for the last day and a half or so how the Tougaloo Nine got started. And we do have varying opinions about how we got started. We were not the Tougaloo Nine at that time. We have since become known as the Tougaloo Nine. So we all got involved at various stages in the activities that were going on at Tougaloo. And all of us at some point attended meetings, we did various things that eventually led to our decision to do the sit-in at the Jackson Library. But we all had different stages and different time periods and different things that we did leading up to that. But since that time, we have coined the Tougaloo Nine. And honestly, it's a little bit embarrassing because at the time, I didn't think it was really all that big of a deal what we were about to do. But since then, I've been doing it. Real big deal.
Anybody else want to comment? Well, as you know, there are lots of creation stories and they're all true. So, I'd like to pass this around, and I would like to pose a general question about were there any other influences? Were there adult influences, people who were you went to, that were talking with you, that gave you advice as you were making these plans? Geraldine, do you want to comment on that?
Thank you, John. How many of you know about anything about Dr. Berinsky? Good, that's great to know. Because I really got a little bit bored with doing some of the regular things. And I would go to the forums next door to Jameson Hall, the building next door. Right at the bottom there was the forums. And every Wednesday we had all of these people coming in to talk. So after a while, I just wanted you to know I got started. But the influence that I had was basically, I just remember the advisor here, Mr. John Mangle, who was our chaplain, and he was a part of that, and a very likable man. And I did join the youth in NAACP, and I guess my biggest influence before getting involved was Joseph Jackson, who was the president of the NAACP. I found early in my life that it really was great to associate yourself with like people, to associate with people that was going somewhere, to associate with people that seemed like they really knew what they wanted to do in life, and not to hang out with a lot of people that you might get in trouble with. That was really easy to do. So I thought to challenge myself by attending, and I like that Joseph talked with me, and I like talking with him. And I think he influenced me to be a part of that group. Thank you.
Ellen Lassiter from Vicksburg, and I'd like to say that Matt Barabas' involvement gave me the confidence, for I have met him at home in Vicksburg. My father, Reverend Lassiter, was one of the charter members of the Vicksburg chapter of the NAACP in the late 50s. And so I had met, seen them discussing things, discussing activities, etc. And so that was probably 4 or 5 years later that we encountered him here at Tougaloo. That's what gave me the confidence that with his leadership, this probably will work.
Well, you met, you got together, you decided you needed to take action. Why did you choose the public library?
As part of the Jackson Youth Chapter, we attended a couple of seminars, a training retreats. The first one was in Keysville, Georgia. My cousin Willis Logan and I rode over there with Metco Evans. The next year was in Frogmore, South Carolina. And quite a few of us took the bus up there. And we met with a lot of young people that had had sit-ins and what have you, and we thought of, well, that started us to thinking of what we could we possibly do here in Mississippi that would be different. And so when I got here, we talked about a read-in. Thank you.
I realize that I don't have to speak to every question, but I do have something to say about every question. I have on pink, obviously, in memory of my aunt, my baby aunt. She was the youngest of 8 girls. There were 10 total. 8 girls and 2 boys. My Aunt Carrie, we called her Millie. She was the youngest, as I said, but she was the most vocal. She had something to say about everything, and particularly with respect to the race issue, how the white folks were doing us, and all kinds of things. So, you know, growing up and listening, I was influenced by that. So I really didn't have a hard time identifying with moves and organizations that were anti that kind of thing. So that was my greatest influence. My Aunt Millie, God rest her soul.
Thank you, Sam, for telling us why you chose the library.
Well, I tell you what, just keep on living. It's called a senior moment.
As to just how the choice of the library came about. Once we stopped meeting as students, I say in mass meetings here in the chapel, it was narrowed down. Somehow we were narrowed down. We narrowed ourselves down to about 11 or 12, and then ultimately 9. It is in those smaller meetings that we had with those 9 to 11 or 12 people that we received advice from Mayor Evers, from Reverend Mangrum, something from Dr. Biden himself. I don't remember his advice. We received help and assistance in terms of where we should go, where we should hold the sit-in, when it would occur, how the press would be notified, how to respond if attacked, I suppose. And finally, that this was could be a very dangerous kind of thing that we were about to do, but that they had our back, so to speak. And it was felt that the library would be a relatively safe place for us, as opposed to a more, private than public place. But also it was perceived that since the library was a public institution, that who could blame us for using an institution where people, where we also paid taxes, or where people in Mississippi paid taxes. So this is gonna be a test case right from the beginning.
You alerted the media in advance very quickly. Why did you call the press? Anybody have a?
We felt that if the event were publicized, or if we were on national TV, or if we somehow there was a feeling of protection that would be afforded us by the media knowing about the event, certainly they would not stomp us, beat us, kill us, or do anything like that if the media attention was up.
So we thought.
When we sat in at the Livingston Park Zoo, the reason that failed is because we did notify the press.
So when they mentioned that we may want to go to the library, I was ready. I was ready. That was the place to go.
Al, did you think that maybe if you notified the press that the police would be there too? And if so, what did you think about that?
Under all circumstances, we knew the police would be involved. There was no way out of that. All around the country where demonstrations had taken place, police were dramatically and violently involved. So we took courses that would enable us to provide the maximum safety for the group.
Now I'd like for, if not everybody, as many people to respond to the next question, and I think you'll know the reason why. Because I'd like to know, once you pulled up in the car and got got out of the car and when you're on your way into the library, what were you thinking about? What were your feelings?
We knew we had to march in rather quickly and take our places within the library and not in the group, but rather spread out. And being the tallest and the most available target, I positioned myself at the card catalog with my back to it so that I could see any blows coming and perhaps block them. And shortly after we arrived, you're right, the policeman walked up to me and said, "Boy, what are you doing in this library?" "Sir, that's a requirement, sir. We're here to check out some books. Your library is down on Mill Street." "Yes, sir. But they don't have the books that we need. But you gotta go down there anyway." And by that time, the paddy wagon pulled up.
Really great on that.
The previous question about apprehension. Anyone not being apprehensive on a day like this was, there's a cemetery somewhere out back. That's where you would have been that day. It was very, very hyped that day. The books that were selected, at least in my case, I had chosen my book weeks in advance. Being a biology major, I knew that there was a rare microbiology book called Burgess Manual on Bacteriology. I knew nobody in the state of Michigan had it. So when I presented my request, they had no comments other than we don't have it. Thank you.
There was a botany professor at Tougaloo College. His name was Gerald Andrews. Some of you may know him. But I had gone to Mr. Andrews, I don't think he was PhD, and I told him that I needed a book that I could not find at the Carver Library, and if he could give me the name of a book. And he says, ask for Introduction to Parasitology. And of course, I didn't know a lot about parasites, but I did kind of conclude that that's what it was about. And they really did not have the book at Carver Library, Introduction to Parasitology.
What they're saying, of course, is that the plan was to go to the Black Library to find out books that were not there, and then to ask for them at the public library, in part to answer the question, why aren't you there? The books weren't there, were entitled to be here. Well, you were arrested and taken to jail. Let me just tell you what I wrote. I make the point that had the officials at City Hall simply booked you on charges of breach of the peace and released you, the city might have been spared a good deal of unfavorable publicity. But you were in jail for, I believe, 32 hours while the sheriff delayed your attorney, Jack Young, who was there to bail you out. First of all, did you consider that you might actually be doing jail time? Did you come with your toothbrushes? And secondly, and this is the major question, just what was it like to be inside the Jackson jail? How were you treated? Were you segregated by sex, by race? What things stand out in your mind from that experience? And I want to hear from everybody on this.
We did expect to go to jail. So that was, in itself, was not a surprise. And true, the women were separated from the men. We were all thrown into the tank. I don't know if you've been to an old-time jail, any of you here, but a tank is a big room where all of the where everybody's put there first, drunks or whomever, or derelicts. And that's where we were first for, I would imagine, a few hours, and after that we were booked. And then later taken up to our cells. I remember Sam and Joe, the three or four of us, and I believe Al, in one cell. And Meredith, you might correct me on this, on the other cell. But it was civil as far as jails go. And we were waiting in front of the bar, sitting out there in the concrete, for seemingly an interminable amount of time. And Rim, that's our roommate Sam, somehow or another whipped in. I think he started with my trench coat and pulled the covers out of the cell. But we made pallets in front of the cell, and to the amazement and probably chagrin of it. The guards as to how they get those covers out. But I give Sam the credit for that. And I'll hand the mic to him.
The answer to the question is whether or not I expected to be jailed. The answer is yes. We were told that we would probably be arrested. That was part of the plan. Didn't have a toothbrush, unfortunately, because I thought that we were going to get out that same day. We did not get out that same day, and we spent, I learned later, 36 hours in jail. I had been telling people for years it was 3 days. it felt like 3 days. I remember the first day, the first meal that we were trying, that we were given, and it was something like some salt pork and something that was terrible. Ritz. Whatever it was, but we left it outside the sale they needed. I didn't want it. About, I guess, the 30th hour, I did start eating whatever they put out there. But the most horrible part of my being there was when we were taken out of our cells individually and questioned by some authority. And I just remember this a white man with piercing gray eyes looking at me and trying to break me down to tell him why we had done or why I had done or participated in such an activity, and wasn't I ashamed of what I had done, and how would my parents feel if they knew that I had put myself and them in jeopardy, and they knew that I was not the person who had come up with this idea. So who made you do this? So that was the most terrifying part of it, but we had been trained on what to answer, how to answer, and he wasn't able to break me down. But it did appear that it was like 3 days instead of 36 hours.
Of course, I came to school that morning not even knowing about the cities. I didn't have a clue. But once we got down and we were placed in jail, we were placed in a big holding room with derelicts, drunkards, whatever they had picked up off the street. And the unusual thing, or the thing that I remember most, is the toilet facilities. There was none. There was a hole in the floor. And so you had to expose yourself for body function. And one gentleman had to do just that. So it was a tough situation. I was on the other side of the room, so I don't know whether there was running water or how that system kept itself cleansed. A stench, I don't know, I didn't go over there. I remember some of the guys singing in the room. And the other disgusting thing about it, that's where we got our first meal, which was lunch. And the thing that I remember most about all the evening meals is that they had big onions chopped up in it. And so that's what I remember.
We had seats. Yes, I knew that in all probability, I knew that we were going to jail. I thought, like Janice, that we would be out that same day. And so there was a bit of consternation when we were not out that day. But it seems to me somehow we received word in the jail that the person who was supposed to sign for us to get out, they said he'd skip town. That was the word. But apparently something, he may not have skipped town, but he left. Mm-hmm. And our attorney could not get us out because he decided to leave. In terms of what do I recall about my time there, just kind of a mixed feeling. I remember, as Janice mentioned, I remember these two men, two very tall men, interrogating me in a very small room, like a broom closet. And one had his foot up on the chair that I was sitting in. And he kept saying to me, you know you're not smart enough to plan something like that. And didn't Megger Evers really plan this? So he asked at least three or four times. He tried to get me to say that we knew right from the beginning that if Megar Evers were ever linked to that, that it would be extremely dangerous for him. Other things I remember are, you know, we were in a great big sale, a pretty large sale, the four women. And they did lock us out of our beds during the day. And so we spent time talking, sitting on the benches, lying on the floor. And later on, we were able to visit with the other inmates in their cell and listen to the tall tales that they spun. And so that was pretty good, because at first we were sort of afraid of how they were going to treat us. And we had no problem with that. And I remember Geraldine just dancing ballet all the time.
first 10 hours.
and so that's fine.
I prefer to stand, so not only will my voice project a little, excuse me, better, but so that you can see me as well. We very definitely expected to be arrested. In fact, that was a part of the plan. And if you guys remember, we were told to not resist arrest. We were not going to leave when that guy walked up and said, "Y'all get up and get out of here." Chief Pierce was standing over me. There's a picture in Jet Magazine, if no place else, with this guy standing up over me, Chief Pierce. And I'm sitting at the table, staring down at this book. And I can't tell you, you know, what the book was about. But I did not move when he said, "Y'all get up and get out of here." But when he said, "You were under arrest," then of course we got up and left. But now in terms of my recollection of being in jail, the one thing that I do remember, and I've told Alfred Cook about this, so he knows it's coming. Alfred was climbing the bars, literally climbing the bars, and making little noises like a monkey. And he did it for us down at the president's home. I don't know if he's gonna do it now, but he still has the stroke.
I forgot to address Al's question. I was in the cell with you guys. And one other thing that I brought with about the cells, the guards brought the police dogs up and placed them in our cell. And that's why we were on the bed and climbing the bar. Oh.
William Pierce, did Evelyn have anything to say that you recall about her time inside the jail?
Well, one thing that I think we all have to remember is that this didn't just come out of the air, this movement didn't, this reading didn't, because Medgar Evers would meet in Laurel with my father, who was Reverend Pierce, and the same mind, if you will, that exists here and in other places, not just in Jackson, but around the state, was present among all of the youth council organizations. For instance, Evelyn's youth council organization, our youth council organization in Laurel, took a bus to Memphis for a training session. And the training session, all these things mentioned here were discussed. So Evelyn was very well prepared for this event because she had been in similar events. For example, in Laurel, a group of students would go through the back door of the library and really actually borrow books undercover, if you would, to take back to our little segregated high school to do actual projects with. So, and I might mention right now, it was at the willingness and the open-mindedness of several white individuals in Laurel who would allow us and Evelyn to sneak into the library and get books. So there are a lot of good white folk in Mississippi. I always have been. I just want to say that. All right. But in answer to the question, did Evelyn ever say anything to us about her experiences? And what she said was like a trooper, you know. We did it. We knew what we were doing, and what we expected happened, and we were able, I mean, she was just like giving a report to us, because actually, this was just one of the many struggles that she had been through, only it got media attention. Thank you.
Expected to be arrested. And secondly, I was not prepared because I didn't think we would be there that long. I thought maybe at most one night. But after that first night, I began to feel suspicious that something is not working for us. And second night passed, and then we began to get bored. Some of the young men and myself sitting in the corner looking sad. And I just thought of things that might cheer them up. And I thought of a chimpanzee that we had when I was in the Air Force and the things that he would do when he became upset. And I climbed upon the bars of the cell, mimicking a chimpanzee, and I jumped down. And you know how an ape walks. They are bipedal, they walk on four. I jumped off the wall and I went across the cell.
Joyce and her sister Dory organized a sympathy prayer meeting, and the next day about 50 Jackson State students boycotted classes and began to march to City Hall in support. Now, as Joyce said last night, about 10 blocks from the jail, the police ordered them to disperse and then use force, charging into the group with clubs, tear gas, and dogs. One thing Joyce did not mention last night is that had they made it downtown, they would have met 3,000 men in Confederate uniforms passing before Governor Ross Barnett in front of the governor's mansion, a short block from the library. What? This was the 100th anniversary of Secession Day. Historians love irony. Well, as you know, those of you who are fans of Law and Order, the final scene is the trial. And I want to move to that now. We have, I think, what went on in that courtroom was very, very interesting. But what was going on outside was also interesting. And if any of you remember just what it was like outside when you were marching into the courtroom. We can start with that and then move to your experiences inside the court itself. Who wants to start?
When we arrived at the courthouse, I remember a bunch of steps. And I remember several German Shepherd dogs with their masters on the steps. And as we proceeded up the steps, one of the guards, police or whoever, with the dog came towards me. And someone yelled, "Those are the defendants." And so he stepped aside and let us pass. And we went on into the courtroom. And I understand there was a lot of bad things happening after we got inside.
Briefly, I was delighted for Dr. Lattner to explain the goings on at Jackson State last night. She explained that the students, of course, were coming in support of the Tougaloo Nine, and we hadn't necessarily been dubbed the Tougaloo Nine at that point, but we certainly had been jailed. But they were headed downtown in support of the Tougaloo Nine and were stopped at Pearl and Rose streets, I believe. But then I asked her afterwards about the people to whom Ethel just referred, who were on the steps, because I thought those were Jackson State students. For all these years, I thought that those were Jackson State students, and it could very well have been Jackson State students, but not the group that Joyce referred to last night, because I know for a fact when we started up the steps, and Ethel straightened me out on that, we were going up the steps, and they started to applaud, and that totally incensed those people with the dogs, and they just sick those dogs on people. And all of this stuff you see about Birmingham and those dogs, I think maybe they may have mixed those tapes up a little bit. Because those dogs were introduced in Jackson, Mississippi.
Let me just jump in here and follow up Sam's account with that of Medgar Evers. I say, outside 25 Jackson police officers and two German Shepherd dogs stopped other blacks who had come to watch. And as Sam said, a tense calm prevailed until the Tougaloo defendants arrived and started walking up to the courthouse steps. Then the large crowd of blacks lining the street broke into spontaneous applause, an act that unleashed the police and their dogs. Medgar Evers, who was hit during this police riot, later reported that, quote, the scene was, quote, indescribable. Men and women were beaten with clubs and pistols. The Negroes had done nothing to provoke the attack. They were not demonstrating and were standing peacefully on the street. Inside, what was the atmosphere like?
Well, let me just finish a comment on the outside. I remember us being brought up or escorted up the sidewalk, and there were blacks on the opposite side of the road, and there were whites on the other end. They came together with some space between them, and the dogs, there were about 10 canine officers up there with the dogs. And I remember very distinctly wondering how I was going to get through those dogs. I didn't want to deal with the dogs. In fact, my pastor at my church asked me what was it that I remembered most, and I said that having to deal with the dogs. So my wife said on the way here that you can't tell the audience that you're concerned about dogs. You got to say something more profound. But the fact is, that was my concern. It's hard to think of something profound when you're worried about a dog taking a plug out of your reed. So, but that's what happened in the picture that was in Jet of the dog entering on Medgar was taken at that scene.
What do you remember inside the courtroom? What was the atmosphere like? The audience, the attorneys? The atmosphere inside the courtroom. You go in, what do you see, what goes on? What were you prepared for? Did you think that you might have sentences where you'd have to go back to jail? Had there been a deal cut? Did you know anything about the outcome? In short, what was going on?
I don't remember really anything about the courtroom. I remember us being put in a small room and asked how we were going to plead. And we were seated sort of in a line. And I don't recall who the person was, but he stepped to the first person and said, "How do you plead?" I was near the end of the line, and I have been very grateful that I was at the end and not at the beginning. Because to my knowledge, as I recall, I did not receive any instructions, or I was face down and didn't hear or whatever have you. So I didn't know how to plead. And since the charge was, breach of the peace, the formal charge, but people were talking about disturbance of the peace, peace disturbance and so forth. And I was sitting there thinking, if I disturbed your peace when I went to the library, then I'm guilty. And so fortunately, the person said, after some pause, "Not guilty." And then everybody else said, "Not guilty, not guilty."
Yeah, it's extremely easy for stuff to run together. And this is no exception. But let me say this before I have another senior moment. We were not sure just how things were going to turn out. In fact, I called my mother the night before to tell her that I'd probably go to jail. And to not worry about me. And she told me, "Just don't say anything." Now, we had supporters who had committed properties and other resources on our behalf. For example, Smith, R.L.T. Smith was one of the gentlemen who had committed properties, and we had others. So we had support, but we just didn't know how we were going to come out. Now, Attorney R. Jess Brown, and Attorney Jack Young Sr. were our attorneys. And of course, you know, they had a lot to overcome, but they did masterful jobs in terms of trying to represent us under those circumstances. I think they were disrespected generally in the courtroom, but I don't remember the specifics of what took place, to be very honest with you.
I would like to go on and on with this, but the hour is getting late. We have awards, we have the choir back with us. I will simply summarize by saying that you were giving what suspended jail sentences and $100 fines that were later overturned. But it was an amazing experience, and you all came back here, right? And were celebrated as the heroes that they very justly were. And as I said, As Merle ever said, the whole direct action movement really started with this group here, and I think we should recognize that. Now, seven of you will now have time to tell us, and I'm sure we're all very interested about what your life after Tougaloo was like.
We'll start with that.
John pointed at me, so I guess it's okay for me to speak. No, my life has been 50 years since, and of course I returned to Tougaloo College in 66, I guess, because I left shortly after the sit-in for a number of reasons, not least of which was a shortage of funds. Even though tuition was every bit of $765, I believe, at that time, it was hard to come by. And I left, worked, and came back to school. I continued to return to Tougaloo to just kind of work off and pay off the debt that I had incurred in previous years. But I finally came back in 1966 and completed a BA degree in 69. Then I went to work at Tougaloo College upon graduation in the Office of Development and Public Relations. Henry Briggs had worked as public relations person for years, but I think I was dubbed alumni giving officer for the first time, such an office, that is. And we managed to raise from an annual average of $5,000, I think we raised $25,000 in 3 years. So I was very proud of that. And ultimately, I went to work with the state of Mississippi, Division of Medicaid, spent about 27 years there, and retired in 2006. I don't want to forget to say that I married Shirley Falkins, who's also a Tougaloo graduate. She's from Meridian, Mississippi. And we've been married for 42 years. Yes. We have two sons, Arco and Peely, both of whom are Tougaloo College graduates. Arco and his wife, Dawn, are both medical doctors in Amarillo, Texas. We have our first and only granddaughter, Eden, and we were out there just last month. Oh, you gave me a chance to talk, so. We were out there just last month for her first birthday. So I know my time is up, but I'm still going to talk some more. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'll speak for number six, Evelyn. And she left Tougaloo and joined the Army. And she left the Army as a sergeant and went back to Highland Park, Michigan, where she was the director of admissions for Highland Park Junior College. And also, she was the city council, elected to the city council, and became the president of the city council. And she traveled to Africa and did a lot of work over there as an AKA ambassador. She married Malcolm X's brother, Abdul, and they lived there in Highland Park. most of her achievements were on the social side of things. She stopped getting into so much trouble. However, if you picked up the Detroit newspaper, you probably found her on one of the pages there as she pushed the system to do better. They have two daughters and about 13 grandkids. She took the name of Amina. She was a queen mother in Africa. She spent so much time over there that she was installed, as they call it, like throne, put a place upon the throne. And she continued to be loved by those in Ghana. That about wraps it up for number six. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Background for you, so I just say that my life since leaving Tougaloo has been kind of busy and quite fulfilling, but with its ups and downs, like everybody else's life. But I've been very grateful for the life that has been accorded me, and for my friends and family.
I dropped out of Tougaloo after the city and due to a lack of funds. I moved to Chicago and worked there a while and then I enlisted in the United States Air Force, where I served in Europe and the state of California. I returned to Tougaloo and graduated in 1969 with a BS in mathematics. By the way, I didn't take mathematics at all in high school, and very little here. In fact, my sophomore year, I took arithmetic and I made a D or an F or something. But after finishing Tougaloo, I got an offer to attend the University of New York at Buffalo. I completed the master's degree there, thanks to my lovely wife, which also completed the master's degree in math. And I taught at Niagara University for a couple of years with a short stop at Attica State Prison. About 5 years ago, I retired. By the way, our son, which was here earlier, grew up in Buffalo, attended school at Prairie View, and he just moved to Mississippi about 2 years ago. And he's an electrical engineer out on Airport Road. About 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I retired. We've been blessed with a beautiful motorhome, and we ride around in the wintertime. We leave Buffalo about November. And we attend wherever it's, we drive around where it's warm. And we will be coming back through this area. And so, by the way, about 10 years ago, I had cancer, big C, thought it was over. Had the surgery. 2 months later, my doctor called the doctor's office and said, the doctor wants to see you a day after tomorrow. I said, what is it about? They said, well, we can't tell you, but he will see you a day after tomorrow. And old Mr. Andy, bring your wife with you. And at that time, I was informed that I had kidney cancer, and I knew about one form that was not curable. Obviously, I didn't have that form. That was 10 years ago, so I've been tremendously blessed. I don't worry about that. I enjoy life, and I'm enjoying being back here. Thank you.
After we got out of jail and returned to campus, life resumed to seem to me as usual. We went on, graduated from Tougaloo. I had been offered a scholarship to Columbia University to begin graduate study. I turned that offer down and chose to return home to Clarksdale, Mississippi to assist with the education of my sister next to me, because my father's plan was that each one get out and help another one get in. So I spent 1 year teaching at community college, high school at the community college in Clarksdale. And after that period of time, I went to St. Louis, Missouri, and became roommates with this lady right here. And it was a beautiful time. We had a wonderful time in St. Louis. I did manage to complete a master's program. I married and had one child. That child is now a graduate of Hampton University. She is back in St. Louis for a minute, doing her thing in television. She is a professional model and entertainer. I'm very proud of her. In my years of building a career, I was an educator, counselor, and administrator at the high school level, college level. And during those years, I guess as a throwback and as training while I was at Tougaloo, I was an advocate, a student advocate, and advisor to student organizations, helping with anything that I thought that they needed help with, participating in sit-ins, asking for and demanding things from administration that I knew that the students were entitled to. So I guess my training here transposed into what I was doing as a career. And was a wonderful part of my life for about 35, 40 years. I then left that and went into real estate. I'm a real estate investor. I do property management, and I buy and sell property and have fun doing that. So I'm enjoying life and having a great time, and am grateful for the years that I spent at Tougaloo, the training that I received at Tougaloo, the support that I received. I believe that it helped me to become the woman that I became and enabled me to do the kinds of things that I've done over the years. Without the training I got too, I don't think I would have been able to do that. The confidence that you get from an HBCU is unbelievable.
My senior, in fact, my junior and senior year, I was on student deferment for the draft, the military draft. Those of my generation, a little younger, would probably be aware that the draft was certainly in force at the time. So I had to make a decision when I decided to join the Air Force. In fact, after joining, I was selected to go to OTS, Officer Training School. I had to get a waiver because of the arrest record that I had. A waiver from Headquarters Air Force to permit me to go to OTS. But that was granted, and subsequently, as you're aware, the charges were dismissed. But I spent, a full career in the Air Force, retired as a colonel. And in between, I was stationed in California, San Bernardino, and I met a young lady who's a speech language pathologist named Josephine, who happens to be here tonight. And she asked, how long are you going to be here? I said, I'll be here a couple of years, because they shipped me out in 4 months. So 6 years later, we did get married, and it's been about 38 years now. Yeah. So she's put up with a lot, I would say. But it was during that career also, I was able to complete a graduate program at the University of Southern California, completed my master's there, and I've been out now about 20 years. I've been working in the financial arena. Insurance, long-term care, and investments. And so that's what I'm still doing even at this season of life, along with the Gideon's Ministry, where I've served in some senior capacities there. But I do, as you also indicated, applaud Tougaloo as a true incubator for success. And it's been a joy.
I told Geraldine that I was going to ask asked her, among other things, to talk about her new book.
Thank you, John, and to each of you. I would like to let you know that I think that being a product or a student of Tougaloo really did move me to excel in life. And one of the things that I did all along was to try to give back in every capacity. As Janice alluded to and Stone told you, one of the things that I did was to get out of school and help my brothers behind me. And we had that pact that we would help each other. My first brother went to the college of in Itabima, and then the third brother went to the Air Force. But the next brother came to Tougaloo, and he is the class of 71. So we worked along trying to help each other. As I moved through my educational quest, I found that it was very easy for me to be married and to go to school. And before I tell you a little bit about going to school in my book, I want all of you to know that I don't come by myself. I come as a pair with Jack Collins. I met him quite early in my life, and we've been together now, I think almost 46 years. I went through the Oakland Unified School District, and I started learning how to write by doing handbooks and workshops and things like that. But eventually, I always wanted to write my story. And I really started by journaling when I went to do my student teaching in the Delta at Allendale. I did my student teaching during the summer, and I finished with all of my coursework, and I got my diploma in 63 in the mail, because I finished my college coursework in August of 1962, after 3 years and three summers. My life culmination was about coming back to Mississippi. There was always an occasion to come back to Mississippi. In 2006, I came back for the 45th anniversary of the Tougaloo 9 celebration, of which I was very appreciative, because I felt as though we really needed to have this acknowledgement. I journaled then. I talked about some of the things at that time. But last year, I realized that this was the 50th year anniversary of the Tougaloo 9. And I had not written my story down. And I really wanted to share this with the world. I felt as though I had something to say. And I wanted to leave a legacy. I know that I can tell you, you can hear about it from someone else. You can read it in the newspapers. But I wanted to tell you my story myself. So last year, while my husband and I was on one of our many trips coming from Mississippi, I started journaling again. That was in August of 2010. And this year, in July, I finished with the editorial and had the book launching. The title of the book, Back to Mississippi. And in August the 29th, I submitted my book to the publisher. And on September the 29th, I received two books in the mail, a paperback and hardback. And that was 1 year of writing, editing, and publication. And I was very delighted to be able to come to Tougaloo with not only my story, but a documentation. And I've always known the documentation beats conversation.
I jumped the gun earlier, gave you most of what I've been doing since I left Tougaloo. There were a couple of things I did not include, and I'd like to include those now. One, as a career, I've always loved money. I've always loved dealing with money and finances. So 15 years ago, I became a registered representative. At that time, with NASD, now as FINRA, I assist people in their retirement programs. I assist people with their investments. I only do Series 6 work, and mutual funds are the target, by the way. I'm not licensed in Mississippi, okay? So I cannot take your investments tonight. The second thing I would like to add, and since no one else has brought that into play tonight, I want to tell you that while I was at Tougaloo, I was a member of the choir. Mm-hmm. 50 plus years since I left Tougaloo, I'm still singing in the choir. I love it. I'm an Episcopalian. I go to church every Sunday, and I sing every Sunday. Thank you very much.
Again, this has been a wonderful evening for all of us, especially for me. And the person who more than anyone else made this responsible was Daphne Chamberlain. Thank you again. Now, who is responsible for the next part of our program?
Miss Amber Williams.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I don't know if you all feel the force that I feel when I walk on the stage just like this. Whew, I'm sorry. It gives me great pleasure to stand in front of such amazing, forceful, courageous trailblazers on behalf of the students of Tougaloo College. I say thank you first on behalf of myself, because if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be able to be in the position that I am now. So I say thank you. And if you heard the quote, one of them said that Tougaloo College was their incubator for success, but now they have become a part of this incubator so that we, the students of Tougaloo College, can lead the way for those that follow after us. So I would ask that the students who have the special presentations for them to come forward. Afghan throws for each of you, and on this throw you'll see that there is the Tougaloo Eagle, because you have served as the wing beneath our wings, and we'd like to say thank you. So first, to Mr. Meredith Anding Jr. Mr. James Sam Bradford. Mr. Alfred Cook. Mrs. Geraldine Edwards Hollis. Ms. Janice Jackson Vales. Mr. Albert Lassiter. And we would like to first pause for Ms. Amina Evelyn Pierce Omar. The members of the Gamma Omicron chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha.
In absence of our president, Glenda Glover, with the members of Beta Delta Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha, please stand. On behalf of Glenn Glover and the chapter of Beta Delta Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha, we recognize the Tougaloo Nine in honor and loving memory of our soror, Amina Evelyn Pierce Omar.
Ms. Iltha Sawyer Adolph. Now put on my other hat. On behalf of the Gamma Psi chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, we would like to acknowledge the two ladies of the Tougaloo Nine who are my sorors, Mrs. Janice Jackson Vales and Mrs. Iltha Sawyer Adolph.
Choir, we'll be seated. I want to thank the members for participating in this program, for waiting now, and for many of this, this will be a real highlight of the evening.
You've been my brother, Lord.
I just want to know when the next choir concert is. This is marvelous. Thank you.
Let's give the choir another round of applause. Tremendous. I used to have a voice like that. Can't quite remember when, but I used to. That's great. This has been a tremendous evening, stupendous evening. And thanks to Brother Dittmer and the fabulous Tougaloo Nine. Let's go, Peter.
The audience, and I recognize faculty, those who have been before and are no longer with us. Obviously, you're still here in spirit because you've come out this evening. And those of you who are alums, would you please stand and let us applaud you? And those, even faculty, that's when you became here. Those who have been here, you are still alums of this place, even though you've left. Would you please stand? Students to stand because you have been educated this evening. So again, what I'd really like to do, because I don't really want this moment to end, even though everybody is probably tired and worn, I want to end as I began this evening. I want you to stand individual because this is your place. It's your home. This is where Dr. Bidel stood and gave us those diplomas. So I'd like you to, since you don't get a chance to do it very much, I'm gonna let you stand one more time. How about it, Meredith Andy Jr.? Would you? James Sam Platt. This is home, and as soon as I can get out of here and get to my telephone, I am going to call the president to tell her how wonderful this is. She can sleep well tonight, even though she's in somebody else's, another space.
Yeah, let's.